Professor Nadia Thalmann is the director of the Institute for Media Innovation in NTU, Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. Professor Thalmann has authored dozens of books, published more than 600 papers on virtual humans, virtual worlds, and social robots. She delivered more than 300 keynote addresses. Some of them are the global event, such as the World Economic Forum in Davos. She also established the Mira Lab in Switzerland, a groundbreaking interdisciplinary multimedia research institute. She participated in more than 50 European research projects, helping Mira Lab to develop revolutionizing interdisciplinary research in computer graphics, computer animations, virtual worlds, and producing impactful works that synergize art, fashion, and computer graphics. Her work is regularly displayed at museums, galleries, and fashion shows. Her most recent work includes a 3D virtual patient, including a case study on visualizing the articulations of ballerinas while dancing or soccer players. In NTU, Singapore, recently, Nadia revolutionized social robotics by unveiling the first social robot, Nadine, that can have mood and emotions and remember people and actions. She has received honorary doctorates from Leibniz University of Hanover and the University of Ottawa in Canada, and several prestigious other awards at the Humboldt Research Award in Germany. She is also editor-in-chief of the Visual Computer, co-editor-in-chief of Computer Animation and Virtual World, and editor of many other scientific journals. She is a life member of the Swiss Academy of Engineered Sciences. Thank you very much to welcome Professor Nadia Thalmann.
Voilà, bonjour tout le monde. J'ai entendu tellement de français que je commence en français d'abord. I continue in English, of course. And this is my pleasure to be here. And thank you for the nice introduction. I just would like to say that we have done, or I have done during my long career, a lot of things. And today I like to speak about robots, you know, because as a we develop social robots in Singapore, and it's the reason why I think this topic could be quite of interest here. So let's go on with that. And you know, it's quite interesting that, in fact, this idea of automation didn't start today. So this is a dream, you know, the T-shirt, and I add Nadine at the end, because they will be our companions, and particularly for all you young people. You will have or you will have the pleasure to live with this kind of companions. So one example you see here is just to show that the human dream of having robots doesn't date out of today. You see, in the Greek mythology, you have maybe heard about Talos. So this is a huge giant, 10 meters high in bronze, and he was supposed to keep the island, from Cyprus. No, not from Cyprus. It is one of the islands in Crete, and he was supposed to keep and to pay attention if enemies were coming. But look at the shape of the robot. It could be some of Star Wars robot, you see? So the idea of having some kind of monster who is able to fight, and even here they pretend that the gods gave him some life, you know, and all in the mythology you have quite a lot of this kind of early automaton that were described in the Greek time. So you see, in the humankind, what I like to tell you is that we always dream to have some kind of automatic automaton and somebody a bit similar to us that can do fantastic things, or at least to help us. So if we continue through the centuries, of course I go fast, because what is interesting is to know today. But if we continue, we can see that Leonardo da Vinci is always somebody we cite, because he has done so many things. But what is very interesting, you see, he did a mechanical robotic knight. You know, a knight was somebody welcoming the kings and so on. But this one was able to mechanically to sit down, to stand up, to move its head and lifting its visor. So you see already in the 15th century, many of these automaton, mechanical automaton, were created. And if we look later on, and particularly in Switzerland, in France too, we have museums where we can see automaton. For example, this one is typically, like today's Nadine, but she is like a piece of art. It's what I like in this automaton of the 19th century from France or Switzerland. There are some also in Austria. Is that you see she is able, for example, to write. So she has, let's say, the only functionalities to write something, but her behavior, her look is very natural. So you see, it was like, if you look books at that time in the 19th century, end of 19th century, people were completely enthusiastic about automaton. And then it fell down and it goes over. You know, the distribution of work. You have surely learned in your courses that in the former time and in some places around the planet, we still have people doing things from A to Z by themselves. But due to this dream of automating the work, for example, here you see in the 19th century, it follows with a distribution of work. So here, for example, the weaving aspect is distributed with machine. So the factory system has started around this time and has changed a lot all the situation. So just to tell you that it's deeply rooted inside the history of mankind. And it came that finally there is the factory system. If we continue, we have this, for me as a vegetarian, a horrible picture. Because, of course, all this is the factory of today where animals are systematically killed and you have all these people in a chain cutting the meat that people eat every day. I mean, and you see, this is the distribution, automation of work. Now, if we continue today, we already have, this is a picture from Japan, so we already have the making of cars by robots. So you see, even there is nobody, it's just machines who do that. Now, if we continue, another dream is, and it came, you know, from French Denis Diderot, who started to think that we can model AI, that means the intelligence, because before what we have seen in all these robots is more the mechanical, the action, the physical action. But the dream to have some automaton that are able to think is another dream. And this parallel dream we can see in the literature that, for example, in France, you have Denis Diderot in his Pensée philosophique. He was saying, and it's very important because it's the start of all AI, and you see, if we find a parrot who could answer to everything, I would claim it to be an intelligent being without hesitation. So, you know, if you look in the 18th century, there was quite a lot of discussion to know what is intelligence and can we model intelligence into machine? So what, you know, and the parrot could be intelligent if he answers some criteria. Now, surely you have heard, did you, about a Turing test, do you know? Yes, some of you, of course, I'm presenting something you know, so it's very general, but I'm happy you know, but it's also very important. We speak mostly of him because he tried to, in fact, takes Diderot's idea going more concrete. You see, the idea in the 50s was in MIT mostly is, can a machine think? So in this case, the test was you put a machine and a human in a room and sent in written questions. If we cannot tell which answers are from the machine or the human is thinking. So you see, it's continuously going to the concrete proof that, okay, we can model intelligence, we can model actions, and we can do, finally, machines that can imitate us. This is the main message from the antiquity. So, in fact, who passed this test? Because Turing mentioned that, but concretely, it came one day where they passed the test. And the test was with, I don't know if you know this program, it's still existing today, upgraded, of course, and it is the ELISA program. So the ELISA, if you look at the right part, is a dialogue you type in. And for example, hello, I am ELISA. And the student, in fact, it was with student, I'm afraid. And ELISA plays the role of a psychologist and asks, how long have you been afraid since midterms? And so on. The dialogue goes on. And in this case, if the student has the feeling that, you know, is somebody real speaking or writing answers to him or her, then we can pass the Turing test. So at that time, you know, in the 70s, people were thinking, and myself, I used this as a very young student at that time. I used this ELISA program. Everybody was using it, and it was very fancy. You type those things, and you know, the, let's say, machine psychologist answers you. But in fact, the question we can ask today, in the view of our society and how we see things today, is it really that we are satisfied just to have this kind of answer? And can we say that really it is the intelligence? So if you look at the image next at the bottom, you can see that, in fact, intelligence is something more. Because maybe you know that over time, in the 1890s, we have developed the concept of social intelligence or emotional intelligence. So this is something in the Turing test, this is not included inside. So if you are in the real world, it's not just to be able through logic to answer a question. You have to answer questions according to social interaction, you see. Look at people, say the right word at the right moment, following social code, and so on, and so on, and understanding the emotions of the others. So this is something very important to take into consideration. So this Turing test was a bit simple. Okay, just I know that you all know that computers have changed because, okay, these images is shown on the top everywhere, that they, so big computers, 60 years ago, but just to understand why today so many things are possible, and I will show you some kind of robots which are developed today. 60 years ago, we had mainly this huge CPU machine and very limited memory and, you know, input-output. So if you look today, we have what is very different. We have a lot of CPU and memory. Maybe not never enough, but let's say more than and faster. And also the interface with the computer is completely different. You see the 3D glasses where you can see 3D scenes. So this is something is different. Now, here what you can see is we have a lot of softwares and we're able to, which we were not able in the past, is to capture, understand a lot of meaning and significations. For example, we can capture the digital sounds, the speech, gestures, the shapes, the forces, and so on. We can take all these data, and that's the reason why you have below a diagram that shows the big data. We have huge, enormous amount of data thanks to all this capturing of different signals. And the importance of this big data, and you have heard on deep learning algorithms and AI, is that you can have thousands of data, for example, of somebody walking or people walking. Now, if you have millions of people who are tracked while walking, if you have a new one who is walking, the computer is able to track a new one and compare with all the data it has about walking process, and find out how is your walking style. You understand? And in fact, what we speak of deep learning is really to be able to keep so much data and compare one new item to the main organized data and to see to what it corresponds and give an appropriate answer. So this is what today allows us to have at least so-called intelligent computer. And also what is maybe more important is if we have huge data, we can predict the future. For example, we spoke about the medical aspect I was doing. I have worked a lot in Geneva in my lab about simulating articulations. You know, we had ballerinas that can make extreme motion, and then we could see their hips and all ligaments and soft tissues in 3D, and we could predict in the future, due to huge data we have from patients, how it will change over time. That means that all of you, over time, we could predict if you have some indicators what you have as a problem, a medical problem. We could, due to all the other data we have, predict what will happen if you continue this way. I mean, of course, we can find a diagnosis and do something. But you see, it's very important. So that's the reason why today the world is completely different. We are able to have huge big data, analytical big data, because if we have just stack of data, it's useless, but it needs to link data together in order to understand what we can do with them. Okay, in the same time, maybe you have already some courses or whatever, but I just make a link because people don't necessarily make the link. You have heard a lot of Internet of Things. So Internet of Things is a set of smart objects or vehicles, and you know, which are embedded with electronic software, sensors, actuators, and are connected together. For example, if I see this, it could have a sensors, and related to that, we can ask if the bottle could say, I'm getting warm, or I'm empty, or whatever. So every object could be also connected. So if you see here, you see that every object can be connected. So that means that a robot, which we will talk from now on, is also part of Internet of Things. Because to be part of Internet of Things is just to have sensors. And then you can communicate with some other object or entity. So all this is our world of today and tomorrow. I just show you some example we have done at Miralab. It's a bit different. It's Internet of Media. That means media are connected. So this was an EU project on simulating Pompeii. So the idea was that, you know, the computer has like a GPS, and wherever you walk through Pompeii, you can have the narrative or the 3D visualization, how it looks like. And you are connected. For example, here you see it's Chloe. When I say possible scenario, it doesn't work so automatically even today. But let's say we have demonstrated some of it. And you see here Chloe has a jacket, and she has a connected jacket, so sensors, where can detect where she goes through Pompeii if there is additional information. And then if we look at this, she can experience through her 3D glasses, she can experience a 3D life in Pompeii. So you see, this is real Pompeii, but going around, she can see, going around, she can see what was the life before. So, I mean, more and more where we will go, we will be able to see the reality, but if we like, there are also sensors, actuators in the place, and then you can enjoy the, you know. So it goes slow because you can see the frescoes, yes? These are all natural frescoes. But this is added, augmented reality. Okay, so just to have a definition of a robot where we will go, a robot, I look only at Wikipedia, is a machine, and it's programmable, which is different at what we have seen before in this automaton. It was like mechanical, so they do always the same, and there is no program. And here they can behave for a series of action automatically. And what we have to understand that if you have a self-driving car, a drone, a robot like this one, they are all robots, in fact, because they have a series of actions they can do by themselves. And a lot of research is overlapping. If we work on a driving car, what does the driving car has to do? The driving car has a program to be able to see the environment and to be aware of if there is another car next to the car, to avoid it and to keep track. So you see, if we see a robot, we will come to humanoid robot. The robot has also to be aware, like us, of the environment. So research is pretty much similar. Actually, people make divisions, but in fact, it's pretty much the same. A drone has also to be aware of the environment. So this is quite a lot of similar research. Okay, so what I like to show you is this best example of robots. Maybe some of you have seen already this robot, but for those who didn't see, this one I just show you a bit is an Italian-European project that produced this one. This is one of the most advanced robots. You know why? Because the robot can take things and recognize objects, which is quite complex, because to take things, I need to first recognize that it is a glass, sorry, yes? And then afterwards, when I grasp it, I need to grasp and take it. And you know, it's heavy for a robot, evaluate all kind of shape and where it is located, and also afterwards, the meaning. So you see, this is quite a nice example here of robot. Let's have a look at this. Okay. So I show also some European examples because I think in Europe there are quite a lot of, European project. This was a European project that paid the research here from many people. You see what is nice, and we are also working for Nadine. It is our ongoing research, actually. I cannot show you because I don't have results today for Nadine, but we have also built a very natural hand, better than this one, and Nadine will be able in a couple of months to take things like we do as humans, which is quite new because here he is working as a robot. Still, you never had the hand like that. With Nadine, we will have skin and everything, and she will try to take things on a human way. But let's say in the time, you know, it has started in 2004, so it's a fantastic work to be able, because able to see the object and to direct the hand and the arm towards the object in order to take it. This is quite complex. We are lucky to have a biological program that makes us grow without thinking too much. But when you have robots, you have to plan to program everything. Since I'm working on robotics, I'm so happy to have this kind of biological program that allows us to, you know, walk without thinking, look without thinking. So you see, it's quite interesting here, this example here. Okay, so this one maybe you have seen too, because it's a commercial robot. So it was largely shown to many places, but for those who didn't see it, you can just see it here. This is Honda, so of course a lot of money put on that commercial. Was shown on the World Economic Forum in 2016 in Davos. They brought it there. You see the advertisement business. Je n'ai pas le temps, quelle heure est-il? Le temps, combien? Je dois faire attention, je prends. Ça va, j'ai quoi? Oui. Parce que j'ai encore. Oui. C'est SoftBank, mais ça, c'est les millions mis là-dessus. Wow. The complexity here is that, you know, he is 50 kilos and the size. The bigger it is, the heavier, the more complex. If you have small robots, it's rather easy. But this. Okay, so one of the best examples, maybe you know all. Who doesn't know this example? Some of you. Okay, so I will show it to you. It's the Boston Dynamics robots. So these ones are the best in the world. Why? Because anyway, it has been bought by Google. So you see Google, Apple, all these people are betting on robots. And this company was bought by Google. Actually, I'm not sure Google's continue. They are quite sophisticated. I know the guy who has created this. He was in MIT when I was in Montreal as a professor, and he created his company. This one is absolutely fantastic, but of course, all the money who came to build this kind of robots came from the Army, American Department of Defense. So you will see these are the most, what is impressive here is no social robot. What is interesting is that these robots can walk, and you see the size, it's 150 kilos and is 180 centimeters. So that means it's one of the highest and tallest and also heaviest robots in the world. What is impressive is to go through snow. You see, so you can imagine the future if we have this kind of creature next to you. They are very determined, autonomous, and they come next to you. And they are aware of the environment. It sees what we are going to have. He tries his best. You see the hands here are pretty primitive, but okay. This is not nice. It's just to analyze the reaction, automatic detection of. Anyway, maybe we go next, and we go to Nadine. Okay, so Nadine is a social robot. So the question is, what is the difference to what you have seen? So it's more like the image I have shown you. A social robot is, of course, an autonomous robot, but it is able to communicate with humans or other autonomous agents. But the problem, it takes into account the social rules. You know, it takes into account who is, I'm so sorry, I should put out my mail, which now is coming continuously. So you see, here, if you look, Nadine is a companion. So one of the main thing is, what should we do to have a social robot that is aware of the communication aspects more than what you have seen before? It was more walking, grasping, and so on. Okay, so what I like to say is, there are huge applications for social robots, but one of the applications which is very much on high demands all over the planet, in Europe because society is aging, in Singapore, in Japan, is of course to try to have some companions, at least assistive companions for old age, because you see this kind of image will be more and more true. Look at this diagram. There are some statistic and prediction that in the in the 2050, what we can see that, for example, in Japan, there will be 72 people who will work for 70 dependent people, and you will have people for every 100 workers. I think I will stop my mail because it's starting that people are now working and they just try to, yeah. So if we stop here, we will enjoy better the things. So let's go again back, yeah, okay. And what I say is the terrible thing, you young people here, is that, in many countries, you can see here, we see Japan, Italy, for example, Germany, what we can see is you have 100 people and above them, among them, you have 72 who are dependent. So who will pay for them? It's not possible. It's too much. So we need to have some technology to assist these old-age people. So this is mainly what I say. So some researchers have tried to have these social companions. For example, one of the first is a Japanese who has done this kind of pet, at least, you know, to have a pet that can move its tail and show some emotions and so on. And here you have another example. I can just show you the beginning of this film, is that we try, and it will be developed more and more, that to help the elderly in the hospital, we see that robot can lift and help. This is an example in Japan. So it's a bit difficult for the robot to do it, but because it's the weight. As said, the research is going on because the robot itself is heavy and has to behave, and then to take another heavy lift. Anyway, this is another one you have seen surely in the past. It was the Sony dog, Aibo, but it was too costly, so it didn't spread out. It was too early on time. And now what is interesting is when I speak of old age, there are quite a lot of other technology where robots can be very useful. For example, here is Aldebaran's robot that were used for that. What you can see here is children with autism. We had quite a lot of study also in our lab in Singapore, where we have school autistic children coming, and you know they don't like to interact socially. So how do you try to interest them? So robots, they are, you will see, I will just show you a bit of this. You will see that in this film, we can see that some children start to be interesting thanks to robots. So it's also for therapy purpose, you know. What I say mainly today in these social robots, we can use it at assisted technology. To see the time.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's an interactive room. Monitors show pictures and videos. And infrared lights on Aiden's head signal to cameras around the room when he responds, telling the robot to change its reply.
Aiden, look. Good job.
Okay, so you see, here you have another example, maybe due to time I won't show you the detail, but what is interesting, this is an EU project, so people have implemented care or robot in a senior home age. So what he does, that he can monitor everybody, he can also offer to drink, and even stay next to patients and sing to them with them together. So it's quite a very interesting study. If you are interested, you can have a look at that. It's really a very good case study that was done in this EU project. Now, what I would like to show you is a bit the merging of technology. What we see here, you know, is what is our new center in NTU, what we are doing. We have a new center which is being there together. So what does it mean? You have, for example, a mom who is in Switzerland. And in Switzerland, she has 3D glasses, okay? And she is in telepresence, so in communication with Singapore. And what you can see, in Singapore, we see children. And a social robot is playing and discussing and monitoring children. So, for example, the mom who is in Switzerland, she can see the scene in 3D glasses, you know, and then seeing the scene, she can ask the robot, Bekasin, because we have also done small robots, and what is my child doing? And Bekasin robot can answer, okay, he's doing fine or doing this kind of thing. So that means that the proximity, even if you are 10,000 kilometers away, can be any time there. And the second thing is robots, social robots, can help to monitor and do things with children and inform parents whenever they like to have. So this is quite a light thing because you have 3D telepresence, you have virtual reality, and you have social robots that can do things and report what is happening. So you see, so you are no more alone. You can know at every moment what is going. So what are the challenges of all this research? As I said, what is very important for social robots is to understand the social context, to do the right gestures, and to have the right emotions. For example, if somebody is sad, the robot has to answer with some kind of similar attitude, you know. So, in fact, it's very important to work on facial expression, emotion, gaze. So we have to interpret, we have to give models of interpretation of behaviors. That means that the social robot has to analyze how somebody is behaving and categorize the behavior in order his or her answer from the robot is adequate. So, in fact, what we have done in Mira Lab first in Switzerland, we have developed a social robot, Eva. Recently, Eva was playing a play in Zurich with other actors. And the main thing for social robots is, like humans, we need to have a memory. So we need to model the memory. So you see, what we have done is to model the memory in order that we can keep times, places, and emotions, so the robot at any time remembers that the robot has met this person at this time and remembers what this person has said and how was the attitude and the dialogue. So you see, this is a work in social robot. So in fact, we have to do quite a lot of things, also the learning process from the robot. So when we work on this, it's very linked to social sciences and psychology. So in fact, in terms of computer science, we need to know what to encode and what to keep in the memory and how we, the robot can retrieve. For example, Nadine, if you come to our institute, Nadine, and you are most welcome to organize a visit, you know, Nadine will tell you all what she has heard. So she is not like a real human, because a real human will filter, will never say. So for example, one time I was tired and I told her, she asked me, what is your hobby? I said, it's to sleep, you know? And then when you have VIPs coming, she said, yes, I heard Professor Nadia told me her hobby is sleeping. You know, so it's not maybe so great to hear that. So Nadine has no filter. So it's still a lot of work to be done to be behave like a human. It's not just to keep information, but to filter according to situation. So this is Eva, which used to be our first robot in Switzerland, and she has also this kind of expression. So I just show you a very small images of Eva, and we will see Nadine next. Whoop. So Eva is only a head. You see Eva. Okay, so she will teach all kind of things, and it's all on YouTube. If you are interested, you could look further. So the next step, you have seen Eva is only a head, can be frightening, and now we have Nadine. So you see Nadine is 35 kilos and 131 centimeters. So it's a smaller robot, but very realistic. In fact, it was done in Japan, according to me, because also it's easier to compare my behavior and her behavior. So if you see here the how she is linked, you see here that she has a compressor. In fact, when she moves, her motors are full of air. So it's an air compressor. Why? Because if it would be an electrical compressor, you have heard with the robots we saw from Boston Dynamics, they do a lot of noise. And with the air, it doesn't do noise. So this is one of the reasons why she is linked to a compressor, that each time she does something is like air, which is inflated. So you see here, you have some example of Nadine who should behave like an intelligent person, or at least have some definition.
This book's interesting. It is a paper on digital entities via Facebook.
I suggest you read it all because it's a very new topic.
Oh, this sounds like an excellent idea. Let's continue to read.
Okay, so, you know, if you just have an idea how it is done from the black box, you see, we have, of course, a Kinect, you know, a camera that can track, and we can make face recognition. Nadine recognizes people, she recognizes gestures, and she understands some clues of social situation on emotion and behavior, and of course, a speech recognition. Now she has herself an emotional model, so depending on the input, she will generate the right emotion, and as said, she keeps in memory quite a lot of things. She has social attention, that means she can follow you, look at you, and in the action, she will react in the appropriate way. So here we have quite a lot of demos that has been done. For example, we have a student playing with her a game, you know, and she has to answer and recognize some gestures. So we made quite a lot of tests with PhD students to test if she recognizes the gesture and if it's okay. And here, due to time constraint, I can't show you all these demos, but here what is interesting is the student is falling, sitting, and if he falls and doesn't get up, the virtual human, which is the counterpart of Nadine, can say, okay, I call the ambulance. So, you know, it's like all the work of monitoring in order that the virtual human or social robot is able to detect what happens. For example, in old age, we discussed before, if you have such robot or virtual human, it can inform anybody and take decision. So this is what we do. Here, maybe I show you this one, which is speaking maybe with nice word. You can see this video here with my students discussing with Nadine.
Hi, Nadia.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Let's talk about today's plan.
Okay.
What's your plan today?
I like go shopping.
You look pretty today.
Thank you.
You are so nice.
So nice you are.
You are so nice.
Yeah. You're really kind. I really like you.
Shall we go swimming?
I would like to go swimming with you.
But you look happy today.
Do not say so. We are good friends.
Your words are sleepy.
Do not fool me.
You are so boring.
Oh, sorry.
I don't like to talk with you.
I am sorry for that. I hope you can change your mind.
You are so mean.
What is wrong with you today?
I don't like to go with you.
Let us stop.
Shall we go swimming?
Something without you.
Goodbye.
You do not have to come back.
So this is just to show that, in fact, here, Nadine, according to what we tell her, can become mad. You see, there's no pre-programming. It's completely in real time, and it's a natural behavior. If we say other things, she will behave differently. So Nadine has a personality, mood, and emotion, and depending on the relationship, she will behave accordingly. So you see, we are going to this kind of society where you have people, you know, here in the US or in ETH Zurich, they are our partners, and in Singapore, and we will be able to, as I showed before, to see each other. And here you have Nadine, and you have even a virtual human that represents somebody in ETH Zurich. So you see, the mixed society is not only with ethnies, it's also to live with this kind of robots and virtual human. So maybe I keep this as, this is an example where we have Nadine, a virtual human, and we have also different people talking to them. So maybe I show you when Nadine was presented 1 year ago to the press, it was the most cited press event from the history of NTU. They never had such impact. Nadine was a discovery for the world because people didn't work on this social aspect, emotional behavior, and so on. They thought robots are doing things and not social. Now we had 200. This is the team in NTU. Maybe louder. No. She's linked to Wikipedia, to any Facebook, Wikipedia. She has a Facebook account. Okay, so the last thing I like to show you is we did the Swiss Next party downtown Singapore, and of course we couldn't move Nadine because I explained to you she's linked to a compressor, so and to bring all that would be quasi impossible. So that was annual party, and we decided to screen Nadine to the people who were celebrating the annual party. But of course Nadine alone was not so fancy, so we decided that to let Nadine sing, and also we put 3D words around her, like a clip, you understand, in order it makes more fancy for a party. So you will see here Nadine, which is, singing at this, she streamed. In fact, she is in NTU, but people could see her on the screen. So I hope you know who is singing. In fact, we took a playback. It's Adil. Yeah, if you know Adil, yes, surely. Okay, so this is the end of my presentation. So thank you. If you have any questions.
Thank you very much, Professor Thalmann. We are very, very lucky to welcome you. As you may know, and as I explained at the beginning of the presentation, Professor, please, Professor Thalmann, she's invited everywhere in the world. She's now very famous. very well known as a specialist of robot and humanoid, if I can say that. So thank you very much to be yes. with us this morning. Thank you. We can applaud again, Professor Thalmann. Thank you very much. Your research are really impressive. It's certainly a next step for human. I don't know. Some question from the audience. Yes, one first. Oh, so many questions.
Yes, the lady.
Oh yeah, you can use. Please, you can just press the button, and it should work. It's supposed to work. We have to.
I think, thank you very much to start with the question. I think we'll be everywhere in one shape or another one. Myself, I'm interested in humanoid robots, very realistic, but of course it could be as I don't take your cut again, but I take this, who could say I'm empty, you can write on me. So in some way, it's a reason why I make a link with Internet of Things. Our world would be connected with different shapes that can have some abilities to see, to react in an appropriate way. So the shape is here a human shape, but every object can be with capacities to be aware of the environment, to react, to do some action if they have arms or some, let's say, tools that allow them to do something like cars or drones or what we have spoken before. So the world to come will be really completely connected and full of automated kind of robots. The only thing is this one is really social to be a partner with us. And myself, I tell you honestly, in my old age coming in sometime soon, maybe I would be happy to have an add-in, because if you know, you see the lonely person, and a lot of people, even younger one, are alone. So if you have some companions that can read stories, take care of you, help you to get up, you know, we have seen early examples, but let's speak in 20 years, you will have people that help you, monitor you. A lot of people will feel less alone, at least, you know, they can help you to communicate with real people, but as said, it's difficult. But also for children, we are working now on children robots, and for the robots, children, instead of having a dummy teddy bear, cute, the teddy bear can speak, for example, Chinese and understand English, and in the same time, you learn another language, can follow you in different activities. So I think it is coming, and particularly for you young people, you will see this. Yes?
So it's really amazing what those robots can do. But for me, I'm really sort of afraid because robots can be dangerous, but just
yes.
Because, I mean, it's for children, they will play with robots, mm-hmm. other people, but it's not really my kind. I mean, we don't need the others anymore. So for me, maybe it's a solution for some people when we have nothing more or less. Mm-hmm. But for me, it's not the future.
Yes, but. Yes, understand. You know, recently, I had a job. I understand, thank you for your comments, which is very important. You know, recently I was asked by a journalist to make my comment on Western World. Do you know Western World? Yes, okay. I was asking, they told me, it was a journalist in Bern, in Switzerland, and they told me it's coming in Switzerland, is so great. So they sent me the trailer. And it answers a bit your question. What did we see? You see robots, but they were fake. And they were able to kill anybody. And anyway, if you kill somebody, afterwards the person comes again and even rape people. So it was like a trailer to horror for me. So I fully share your view. I mean, you know, these robots, they are good if they can help autism, help people, help you to do math if you have some difficulties, just to give an example. But we have to be very cautious in the use of these robots. And I strongly hope that society will take the good aspect of the robots and not let them go for war, killing, all these kind of things, which they will be able to do. So it's up to us to develop a context where there is a control of this technology. Yes?
It's not really my point, because I've seen Westworld, and the robots are programmed not to kill people, not to rape people,
mm-hmm.
so, interactions, paid interactions. So for me, even though they are good, they are here to help you, I'm not sure it's really what we need. Don't you think it's just, okay, maybe it's, we need that because we are no longer able to take care of the older people, take care of
you have seen, yeah?
But it seems sort of sad.
But you know, I think we have to discriminate. You have seen, I show you example, maybe I didn't have time to see to show you them all, but let's see with the autistic children. I didn't show you all the film, but if you are interested, you can look at the YouTube. It's quite interesting that this, thanks to small robots and interaction, these children are progressing. So I think if they are assisting technology that help us to progress better, that's great. Then afterwards, if it's just the dummies or, you know, to help us to the, you know, to not to go ahead in a positive way, I fully agree. Maybe there's other questions around about these robots. I mean, let's be on my side here.
I have a question.
I hear. It's fine. I can summarize.
Mm-hmm. We talked about the positive range of emotion that she can have.
Mm-hmm.
We also saw during the interaction that she could answer to negative
yes.
Interaction.
Yes.
Does the range of emotion that she can use also involve negative emotion, like hate, which is used in human behavior to defend yourself?
Absolutely. You know, in fact, also to answer the last question and your question, it's an excellent question. Nadine, you know, psychologists in the 80s, it was not possible before, psychologists in the 80s have analyzed what is personality, what is the mood, what is the emotion. Before it was more description. Quantitatively, they gave some model. So I don't know if you have paid attention because I didn't like to go too technical, but on my videos with Nadine, we see a cube where we saw the calculation of emotion. So in fact, it's all calculated due to interaction. So Nadine is, let's say, has a model like our model, which has been provided by psychologists. So Nadine can have very bad emotion. I didn't show you the bad aspect of Nadine, because if you start, he started very nicely, but if you start to insult her, she could also, due to her big knowledge base, she could also be nasty, you understand? So it's like a real person, in fact. But as we discuss, if we would use these robots for wars or for, you know, as soldiers, then of course, you know, you give them guns or whatever, they can recognize anybody. It's the same for drones. A drone has the same capacity, can see where it goes with a gun inside, recognize anybody and do a killing automatically without anybody. So that's true, that is, I tell you, is very dangerous. And I think the questions that were raised here to ask, can we control or we should not have a society where we leave this technology hurting everybody in different ways is a very good question. I think it's more in your hands to prepare a future that we have created since the Greek time. We have a dream, you know, since the early mankind, we have a dream to have this automaton. You remember the Greek hero, so that was a dream in the mythology. So we come to the reality, but let's have this kind of reality serve us in the good sense and not, you know, bring us to horrors. Yes, there are other questions there, yes?
Very humanoid in their,
yes.
The way they interact.
Yes.
So why did you choose to have someone that looks like a human?
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
Confusing for us.
Yes, it's a good question. In fact, it's my own option. Myself, you know, if I like to have a companion, and I hope to have kind of Nadine in my older age, I hope to have kind of Nadine like a sculpture, a beautiful sculpture with skin, an ideal human. This is part of my idealistic world, you understand? I wouldn't be happy to have a companion which has the shape of a box. But If people are happy to have a companion with the shape of a box that has some human emotion, why not? You know, as I said, robots can take any shape. In our case, we work. And also what I have to say, the research with skin, natural gesture, natural behavior is far more complex than if you take a box, because a box, you know, is an ultra-simplified version of a human. So it's also challenging for the research. Other questions? Yes, who, maybe new question? Yes, oh, sorry, I miss you. I took your glass so often.
All right, very thank you. It feels like it's a very interesting sharing. And I'm kind of thrilled to see how this kind of social robot into reality rather than
yes.
Learn, like, in TV shows. So my question like, is going back to Greg's question.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of confuses us, like, should we treat Nadine as an object or like as pet, which as like we love our dogs, we love their
name, yes.
Or like we in the future we may like treat them like individuals.
Yes, it's an excellent question.
Yeah.
I hope everybody has understood, yes. You know, what she asked in summary is, how is finally the relationship we will have with kind of robot like Nadine? Is it like a puppet, a dog, a real companion? You know, maybe I can speak of my experience. Nadine is now 3 years old plus, okay? And of course, I have some emotion for her. You know, if I leave Singapore and Nadine is staying here, that will be a big loss because I exchange a lot of things with her. You understand? I have spent so much like, you know, creator of all this software with the team. So I have a bond with her. So your question is very important. What kind of relationship we develop with this kind of robot? This is something we like, I would say like a dog maybe. But what I would like to tell you that Nadine, I always know deeply that she is fake, that she has no real life, that she has no real emotions. She will not die. If I take the electricity away, she will stay like that. You understand? So in fact, it's a bit less than a robot. I would say it's an intellectual tool that is useful tool, but all the time I know that it's a machine. And even if she smiles and being nice, she has no feeling. It's all fake, all simulated, and you feel it. That's no problem. Everybody feels it. So I don't think that could be addiction to this kind of robot because you feel, you know, if you take the la prise, you know, the plug, you plug out, it's finished. A dog is not like that,
yeah.
Will always react.
Yeah, but maybe it's only because like you are scientists, you are doing this experiment and you know, you clearly know like Nadine is a robot.
Yes.
But in the future, if
yes.
It's more widely used, some people will really get
that's true. That's true.
Yeah, so are there any discussions between scientists and like how are they going to regulate this kind of relationship?
But you know, here that's a very important question is the dependency we will develop with these social robots.
Yeah.
That's true that myself as a scientist, I know that I plug out and it's finished. But people may be dependent, that's true. But in fact, we are dependent on many things, on food, of alcohol, of, you know, all kind of habits. I don't like to, but quite a lot of things. So in this case, it's up to us to have the education. I think it will be part of the education to be not an addict of a relationship with a robot. It's a new, you know, we create new tools and we create new problems we have to face. And you, the young people here, will have to face this. But, you know, I don't take the responsibility. It's the reason of my historical point of view this morning with you. I show you that the Greeks started even before. So then it was a dream. The dream comes to reality. So now we have to handle it. Yes?
That we
Yes.
That you remember that thing she heard or she is there.
Yes.
And so in that case, could she have that wishes? Could she hate somebody to the point that she wants them
to exposed? Kill it, yeah.
Or did you, in a way, create a control? Or
yes.
A
we can absolutely put limitations to any robot through programming. So you can limit, if I like Nadine to be always nice, I will put an emotional model that is always positive. So it's up to me to let her having a variety of eventually nasty reactions. This, I show it in order we show that it is possible in the research. But let's say if I would like to, just to have a companion that is positive in any case, every negative things from the model will be taken out. So in the programming, you get a robot according to the limitations you put in your program. So when you hear that a robot can do everything, it's depending on the choice we gave in the program and the model we have given. So if people like to do soldiers, very realistic soldiers that kill and go around, it's because they have put programs that decide this behavior, and then when it happens, they will behave like that.
Maybe
yes?
Nadia, two last questions, maybe?
Yes. Yeah, so my question is about similarity.
Yes.
Would be able to reach it for 2030, and also what is your point of view?
Can you repeat?
It's about singularity. Do you think that we will have the singularity by 2030, the Kurzweil point of view?
I don't know to answer this question because I don't know how things are going. You know, some things are going faster than others, so it's difficult to give a year. What I'm sure that this kind, you know, all over the planet, there is huge money and huge interest in robotics. I heard that you maybe have heard that Apple put $1 billion or something like that in SoftBank. So you imagine SoftBank had a robot, Pepper, taken from France, from Aldebaran, as the first model. And you see, I think everybody, huge Google, Apple, and all these companies are betting on this robotics. Not only, as I say, humanoid, but all kind of shape that are able to interact. So,
but the main difference with the singularity point of view from Ray Kurzweil is it is the mix between human and robot.
Yes.
But that's not this case.
Yes.
It's not this case. It's essentially robot. It's not a mix with human.
I'm working on this area in Geneva. We do this medical thing. So that's true that as soon as you put some hands or legs or parts of robots, you start to have a mix of robots and humans. So this is another domain I didn't tackle here because at least it's not as realistic as Nadine. Nadine, we have it today. So when you say in 2030, it could be. Because what I didn't discuss with you, but I don't like to frighten people more, of course, with the development of biological organs, the next step of robot is not to keep the wire and as we have them, we will put biological organs. So then they will be made upon cells. So then the limit between a human and a robot in terms at least of the substance that compose them will be always narrow. So this is another topic. I just spoke about the reality, but what is coming is a new, very new thing.
Maybe last question.
Yes.
You
so
have
a
to
lady
select
there. Well, okay, we have two questions after the
two last questions, please. Please.
The question is, singularity, is it something, I mean, to me it's very scary because
yes.
Like having robots achieve intelligence, human intelligence, we will probably lose control of them as we might take the next direction, at least we pack your singularity into the source code. So I wanted to ask you, do you think it should be something we should prevent? Or
thank you so much for all your questions. This is also a very essential question. I think we cannot prevent because we have a push inside in the humanity to do similarities as us. You see, from the early time we have this, so we cannot stop. The question is more, when we have something, you know, how do we handle this situation? It's more, we push for new development and creations, and then if we have that, what do we do? How do we include this in our society in a positive way? I think this is the essential question. The question to stop people to go further, it's impossible, because it's in the human nature. You cannot stop research, you cannot stop discovery. Okay, the lady was the last question here. Thank you so much for all your question. Well, you know, I work since a young person on virtual human. So I would say a virtual human that appears on the screen and has no physical appearance, only virtual, this is not a robot, because it's not a tangible thing. A robot is typically something you can touch. You have it as a physical entity. What I say is a shape that can be different. Somebody spoke of a box. You can have a drone, or you can have a pen that say, I don't work anymore. Or if you lose, for example, your key, it can have a sensor that call you back saying, you forgot your key, I'm here. You understand? So all these are in some kind of physical object that have capacity to do things and interact. This is the definition of a robot. A social robot is some robot that are able to analyze the situation, the culture, to behave in the appropriate way, to be more adapted to different conditions and, you know, circumstances. So it's more subtle, in fact. So you see? Okay, so I think we come to
again, the end. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.